Our current model of growth has worked miracles, and it has lifted billions out of poverty into a prosperous and rewarding life. So meddling with it, also because we have invested so much into it, seems reckless at best. Particularly at a moment where there are billions queuing up to join the middle class over the next years. And yet, there is skepticism around the long-term viability of this model. And there is no escaping the overwhelming evidence that we are destroying our planet at a breathtaking speed and at a breathtaking scope, and that our societies are fragmenting in a way that we haven't seen ever since the Second World War.
America first!
So, is there a way to change direction? To rethink the economic model altogether and to prosper within the capacity of this planet? I think the answer is yes. In many ways, we have been through an impressive, unprecedented period of economic growth. Just look at the outcomes. Even since 1990, GDP has tripled. The number of people in extreme poverty has been cut down to half. Literacy rates are up, child mortality is massively down, access to fresh water is up. And I could go on and on and on. The citizens in the most advanced economies today enjoy products and services that even kings and emperors could have only dreamt of 100 years ago. This impressive growth has been fueled by the increased use of natural resources. This success is largely on the back of natural capital being transformed into other forms of capital ever since the early days of the Industrial Revolution. So ores and coal were transformed into metals and later on into products. And the limestone was transformed into cement and then into buildings and into bridges. Then wood forests were transformed into timber and then into steam, into heat. And so over time we learned to tame more and more forms of natural capital and to transform it into ever more advanced products. Well, this is very well understood. What is probably less well recognized is that even today our model of economic growth continues to be largely based on the excessive and intense use of natural resources. And this matters. If we don't appreciate the crucial role that natural capital plays for our economic success, we will undermanage natural capital and our planet's ability to regenerate itself and to provide that natural capital, and we will underreact to the threats and the signals that we are receiving when we are depleting our natural capital, and it will get in the way of our future economic success. Much that has worked in a society of a billion or 2 billion or 3 billion people doesn't work in a society of 5, 7 or soon 10 billion people. Our economy has grown so big, so fast, that it is quickly depleting the very same natural capital on which it thrives. From the shortage of fresh water, from the loss of phosphorus, the pollution of oceans, soil degradation, biodiversity loss. The effects of natural capital have been long documented and long communicated. Very often when we discuss this central threat of the 21st century, we're looking at the energy sector. Hardly do we discuss our use of materials and resources. The UN-supported TEEP report, which stands for the Economics of Ecosystems and Biodiversity, concluded that 2/3 of the environmental damages actually comes through materials, the wrong use and the overuse of materials, and only 1/3 through the wrong use and overuse of energy. So while our energy demand and the combustion of fossil fuels remains a major resource challenge, our material use is arguably even the bigger one. this material use has received much less attention than the energy aspect of our environmental discussions so far. Now, a change is coming to our economy, and it's the one fueled by technological disruption. Advances in smartphones, in artificial intelligence, in 3D printing, in biomaterials, in quantum computing, in robotics, big data, automation, new materials. Many technologies will disrupt our economy, and they will fundamentally redefine our ability to use resources and create prosperity out of them. The question is, will this be a good disruption or will it be a bad one? Will it help us to rehumanize society or will it dehumanize society? Will it strengthen our link to the planet or will it destroy it? What does it take to make it a good disruption? So one answer that is being offered can't be the right one. The right answer can't be that we are growing ourselves green automatically. We need to have a different answer. We need to move to a different system altogether. What I'd like to propose is that new answer rests on three pillars. Pillar number one is abundant, clean energy. Renewable energy technologies have been on an amazing journey over the last 10 years. They have been outperforming against all our expectations in costs and in volumes. Their costs are now broadly on par with the incumbent fossil fuel alternatives. So once the energy system is clean and able to provide energy at low cost, it will provide a boost to our economic development. Very much in the way fossil fuels have done at their time in the earlier days of the Industrial Revolution. And our strategy should be to make clean energy at low cost abundantly available to the economy. So that's the first pillar, energy. And whilst it seemed entirely unthinkable only a few years ago, now for the first time collectively, it appears thinkable that we are in fact defossilizing, decarbonizing our energy sector. Not so the second pillar. We are only starting to understand it's important. The second pillar of our future economic system is what we call a cradle-to-cradle material bank.
Wouldn't it be lovely if...
Just imagine a circular material system where materials are used over and over and over again, or they are safely returned to the biosphere. This would come with massive economic benefits, not only because today's system of resource use is so wasteful, also because it would address the massive environmental costs and also the massive health costs that we are incurring today. Most materials can be used almost endlessly as long as they are kept pure, as long as they are designed for disassembly and reuse, and as long as we have tracking systems in place that allow us to identify what it is once they have passed through the first use cycle. Through applying better design principles, a country could almost turn its entire stock of in-use materials into a competitive asset. It would unleash a major boost of innovation as companies are redesigning their products, but also as they're redefining the relationship that they are holding with their customers.
I like this.
This is my newest one. Oh, I love this one like I love my two bambini.
But there's a third pillar needed, which is what we call a high productivity regenerative system. So even if we had abundant clean energy and even if we had a material bank, And if we were using all our materials in use as a competitive asset, it still needs to be embedded into high-performing systems that are delivering the mobility we want, that are delivering the built environment that we want, that are delivering the food we want. So systems are the unit of change. So higher utilization of resources through sharing, virtualization of activities so that we are avoiding products in the first place, better integration of products into systems, mobility systems, food systems, built environment systems, and less wastefulness overall are a huge economic opportunity. And due to technology, this is feasible for a first time. It wouldn't have been 5 years or 10 years ago, but now it is. So let me describe you a vision of what such an economy would look like. And let me draw upon three systems: the mobility system, the housing system, and the food system, which collectively account for more than 60% of our consumer spending and over 80% of our resource use. So it's a big part of our resource economy in Europe. And let me show you how that economy would look like if we were building it on those three pillars. So let me start with the mobility sector, which is a huge $10 trillion market. It is currently being hit by a major wave of technological disruption. Autonomous driving, new materials like carbon fiber, sharing, electrification. However, the real opportunity doesn't lie with any of those technological breakthroughs. It would help us to build a supercar. It wouldn't help us to build the mobility system that we need and that we want. Our current mobility system is highly wasteful, and there is a risk that the fast introduction of new technologies will in fact lure more people into car ownership and clog up our cities and clog up our streets and motorways.
Well, I went out to buy myself a brand new car, and the dealer man showed me this fastback, wide-track Detroit shooting star.
So what is the alternative to a mobility system where cars are utilized at 2%? We could imagine a system that is well planned, where fleets are managed, where public transports and individual transport are well integrated, where transport is shared, and we could summon a car just with our smartphone as we need it on demand. Just imagine, the system would monitor traffic, it would predict demand ahead of time, it would manage vehicle servicing and charging and allow predictive maintenance. Those cars could be used for 500,000 to 1 million kilometers as opposed to 200,000 to 400,000 kilometers today. At the end of one use cycle, 40% of the parts could in fact be recovered and returned into the next use cycle. With that, the availability of mobility would be much better than today, and it could be provided at a significantly lower cost.
It is a tragic story of rich land worked too hard for too long a time.
The second system I'd like to talk about is the global food system. Our current food and agricultural system is in need of a significant system redesign. At present, there are many challenges we are struggling to overcome. We are losing more than 2.5 tons of soil per hectare every year. Water abstraction, massive nutrient leakage into rivers, lakes, and oceans, and a huge amount of waste. And that is happening at a time where world population and particularly demand for food is continuing to grow. Essentially, the nutrient link between the field and the city has been broken. Let's just imagine a world in which this nutrient link is closed again, where nutrients are returning. Imagine a world where food waste is separated out of our remaining waste stream, where we are putting it through a process of anaerobic digestion to win energy out of it, and where we are returning biofertilizer back to the fields. So let us imagine that we adopted farming practices that are not depletive but regenerative, where we are not losing soil, but where soil is building and improving year after year. Let's imagine a system where we are adopting no-tillage practices, where we are adopting precision farming practices so that we are applying the right inputs at the right place and at the right time. And let us imagine a farming system in which we are rotating our crops and choosing the right crops for the right location at the right time. Next, let's imagine we could in fact reduce the 31% of food waste that we produce. There are many approaches in which that can be done step by step through the value chain, which will allow us to arrive at much lower levels of waste. So, are we heading towards that vision? Rather the opposite. We are moving away from it. We are applying more and more fertilizer to our fields to compensate for poorer soils. We are not recovering our food waste. We are not separating it from other wastes. So we are moving away from that vision. Yet if we were to take this new approach to heart, it would mean that we have a dramatically better and healthier food system, with much less need for irrigation, for fossil fertilizers, for pesticides. We would have a much better long-term productivity. We see our soils recover. We had lower risk of food crisis. The point that I'd like to make is that the technologies in order to do that are available today. The housing sector, the built environment sector, is one that offers a huge potential to adopt smarter system-level approaches. Buildings could be erected much more cheaply and at a much higher performance than we currently do, and the technology for that is available. Next, offices and hospitality locations offer an enormous sharing opportunity, as visualized in the staggering success of Airbnb. In many cities, the amount of residential space that is unused by far outpaces the amount that is available in the professional hospitality sector. And lastly, urban planning is back. A better planned urban environment allows us to recover space which is currently lost to other users, particularly mobility, which typically takes up 50% of our cities. It would allow us to recover that space, make it into places to work and to relax and to live. It would allow us to introduce urban agriculture, garden farming. It would allow us to introduce better, more healthy materials. What we are seeing here is that system level change in mobility, in built environment and in our food system are starting to dovetail in a way that is creating better economic and social outcomes. So these three systems alone, mobility, food, built environment, represent huge positive changes to our lives, to our economy, and to our environment. It will be an era of creative destruction, of fundamental redesign, of testing our orthodoxies, of experimentation, but also of redistribution of value between different actors. And for that, we need leadership, not management, leadership. There's a massive opportunity ahead of us, and it's ours to grasp. I could not think of a time that is more rewarding and more exciting to live in than now.